So, how effective is the legal framework for women, policies in Africa and Zimbabwe?
Well, I speak more about Zimbabwe, although what happens in Zimbabwe really is the same in a whole lot of other African countries. Most of our legislative framework looks absolutely fantastic on paper. You know, you look at your constitution and the number of times that women are mentioned and the equality clauses there, etc. It all looks honky-dory. It lo all looks fantastic. It all looks like, wow, you know, Zimbabwean women are catered for. You know, we've got a gender commission, we've got equality clauses in the constitution. The constitution says that there has to be gender parity in all appointments, all on paper. The reality on the ground is completely different. And sadly, a lot of us women are complicit in this because we are not insisting on enjoying those rights. When last did you hear female MPs and female senators talk about gender parity? Anyway, why do they agree to stand for elections when the gender quota is not met in the list? Why are they not saying, if this list does not have 50% women, we will not stand as women? Have you ever said, heard them say that? No. And the men have seen our weaknesses. Men will not go to strong women to say, stand. Because they don't want that competition. They know that strong women will give them a run for their money. So they'll choose all the weaklings to be in positions of power. This is why you hardly ever have these women contributing debates in parliament, in senate. You know, you hear Themba Mliswa more than you hear any female in parliament. And you ask yourself, why are they silent on all these gender-related issues? You've seen many, many abuses being meted out to women. Have you heard women complain about that? Have you seen them saying, we will march, women will not be treated like this? No. So, although in terms of legislative framework, we do have lots of, gender parity clauses in our legislation, in practice, we are not enjoying that. We also have a judiciary that is absolutely not gender friendly, which I'm always surprised by because there are more female judges than men. We have done extremely well in terms of having females in positions of power in the judiciary, within the judiciary. You go to Anti-Corruption Commission, we have a woman. We go to Head of ZAC, we have a woman. We go to Judge President right now, we have a woman. You look at the number of women in the High Court, in the Supreme Court, loads and loads of women. So why are our female judges not interpreting the law in order to enhance the rights and the lives of women? Why are they skirting around an interpretation that is very clear? I mean, maybe there are two judges who are very, very clear in their interpretation of laws to favor women. Justice Tanga, each time you read her judgment, you can see that, oh, okay. You know, she really is trying hard to make sure that there's gender parity in the judgment and that all these, legislative provisions are actually given life to, you know. Justice Makarau, from time to time, also her judgments, you can see that, you know. But generally, the interpretation of our laws is completely not alive to the need to make sure that there's gender parity. Zimbabwe has ratified a lot of international treaties and conventions dealing with equality as between the sexes. Our constitution makes international law in Zimbabwe now, but we're not seeing that. Again, you see Justice Sanga and perhaps to some extent Justice Makarau doing that. But generally, you know, if you bring in all these international conventions, you would laugh if you look at some of the submissions that go into court, and when the judgment comes back, everything you would have said, particularly on rights-based issues, will simply just be ignored, completely ignored. So the interpretation of our laws by the judiciary is another big problem. We also have too many gaps in some of the legislation. I just pick, for instance, on marriage laws. I mean, for God's sake, why do we have so many different marriages in Zimbabwe that have different consequences for the women in particular, you know? Why should a woman who's been married for 50 years because only Rora was paid, why is she regarded as being inferior to a woman who's been married for 3 years under the Marriage Act? I mean, that's just so absolutely unbelievable. Why don't we have one umbrella for marriages in Zimbabwe so that the consequences of ending a marriage or the consequences when a spouse dies are the same right across the board? Why don't we have that? Why are the women who are in positions of power doing nothing about that? And why are the courts not saying, yeah, we can see that this is the law on this particular type of marriage. We are giving the government, we are giving parliament 6 months within which to bring this law into line with the constitution, which requires equality. Why are the courts not doing that? So, you know, there's a lot of gaps in the laws that need to be filled up. The judiciary could play a role in filling that up by being proactive and giving the legislative branch of government time frames within which to do certain things. You hear a lot about realignment of laws. Why has the Constitutional Court said you have 180 days within which to realign all these laws? Because we're tired of having to deal with issues that have not been realigned, you know. So we're all to blame for not really pushing some of the benefits that should be coming out of, for instance, our 2013 constitution.
Oh, that was quite well explained.
Yeah.
Thank you. So, and lastly, on human rights in general, do you think political contestations are contributing more to human rights violations in Zimbabwe?
Oh, absolutely. There's no question about that. I mean, if you look at most of the human rights violations, there's a political aspect to it. Whichever way you look at it, there's almost always a political aspect to it. Firstly, the politicians have generally, you know, used you young people to fight their battles through violence. When we talk of political violence is not caused by the Madaras out there. It is the foot soldiers, and those foot soldiers are you young people. And a lot of those violations occur because you allow us older people to use you. And because it is the political contestation, there's no question that that violence comes from there. I mean, there's very, very few instances of human rights violations that are not traced to the politics. Our politics has become so toxic. If you think differently from me, if you believe differently from me, you become the enemy. And if you are the enemy, instead of us, you know, going into the ring to contest fairly, you know, we want to contest physically through violence. So there can be no question that this is a part of the problem. If you listen to the language of the politicians, it is violent. It is extremely violent. How many times have you heard our politicians saying, "Pasina ningi"? What does that mean to their foot soldiers? When you say down with so and so, you're saying so and so must be harmed, correct? So they follow that. When you hear presidents saying, "Aneshamine munyu," what is he saying? He's saying, "I'll whip you into action with that whip, with that salt." And when you get that kind of speech from the top, do you think anyone under him is going to be encouraged to not resort to violence? Because Shamine Monyuga is for beating you up. So everybody will take it from the perspective that that is okay. So the language used by our politicians encourages violence. The actions by our political leaders encourages violence. The messaging we send out to you young people is to say, beat up your opponent. You know, I'll give you a t-shirt and a scarf. Go and beat up your opponent. So politics is largely to blame for the violence that we see. Even in the farms, even in the mines, you know, you find that the violence has political connotations to it, because some powerful political person wants this mining claim, then they'll use violence to get rid of who is there. Because I want to take over your farm and I have more power, I'll use political violence to try and dispossess you. So virtually every act of violence and violation is traced back to politics.